welcome to the Goldberry Artisans podcast, a podcast about knitting and other fiber-related crafts and about learning as you go and being okay with making mistakes. My name is Emily, and I am coming to you from the beautiful state of Maine. You can find show notes for this episode at goldberryartisans.com, and you can find me on Instagram as Goldberry Artisans and on Ravelry as Emily Ruth B. And I just did want to say I don't have show notes for the vlog episodes. I've done two of them so far, two vlogs, and I do not have show notes for those just because editing a bunch of little clips and getting them in the right order and just trying to make it look nice is a lot more work than editing a normal podcast episode. And it's also the content is more all over the place. So it's just trying to edit and have show notes and writing out show notes at the same time is just too much. But most things that I talk about in my vlogs, I normally, like any knitting projects, generally get mentioned in my podcast episodes as well. So you can always find links in my podcast show notes, or if all else fails, just add me as a friend on Ravelry, and or just look at my project pages. So yeah, I think that's all I wanted to say by way of introduction. Oh, I did want to say that I had hosted a giveaway last month to celebrate reaching 200 subscribers, and I had picked a winner, waited I think a little over a month at this point, and the person who won never got in contact with me, so I went ahead, picked a new number, went to random.org, typed in numbers 2 through 21, because my post was post number 1, and the winner is post number 11, who is Knockout Kyla, who is Kyla of the Arctos Knits podcast on YouTube. And she's a fellow college student who loves knitting, so that was exciting. So congratulations, Kyla. Just get in contact with me and send me your address, and I'll send your prize on its way. Alright, so now I think it is time to move into knitting. Today, I am wearing my There Is Still Much That Is Fair shawl. This is the Ohm shawl by Andrea Mowry. I'll show you some of the color work and fun patterning on the edges. It's been really warm out lately, but today it just plummeted. It's like 30 degrees colder than it was yesterday. So I was kind of cold when I came home from work, so I just decided to get all cozy in my nice warm shawl. Alright, so now the actual knitting, what I'm knitting now. To start off with, I have one finished object, and it was also a new cast on since my last podcast. I mentioned it in my vlog. But this is the MET by Carrie Bostick Hogue. I knit this for a couple in our church who's having a baby, and the baby shower is next week. So I wanted to have something hand knit, but it's the baby's due in May, so it's hard to come, you know, I was trying to think of a good hand knit for a spring, summer baby. So I was thinking like a little, I was looking for a t-shirt pattern and remembered that I always loved the version of this for adults is called the Imogen tee. This still needs to be blocked. You can see in the lace section, if I can hold it, be good. The lace was a simple, fairly simple, straightforward pattern, but it does need to be blocked. The yarn that I used for this was Plymouth Yarn Happy Feet in colorway number 14, which is sort of like a green, blue, sort of tealy color. It is superwash merino with a little bit of nylon. I mean, which may not make it the best summer knit, but I did knit the 6 month size, so in a few months the weather will be cooling down again anyway. So yeah, just a fun, super quick little knit, but I wanted to make sure that I got it done in time, so a lot of my other knitting has been put on hold for the past week or so while I worked on this. But this is the first time I've ever actually done raglan sleeves on anything, so it was nice to have it to do that for the first time on such a tiny garment, especially one where you knit, like, hardly any rounds of the sleeve before actually joining on. So most of the sleeve knitting was in the yoke and the decreases, not just on the sleeves itself. So yeah, super quick, easy knit. If you're looking, if you have summer babies that you know are coming, I encourage you to check out the Imogen Tee, not Imogen, M-E-T, by Carrie Bostacogue. Alright, so that's my only finished object this week. Most of the projects that I have on the needles, you've seen before. This is my Waken Up the Flowers sweater. I'm not sure why it's so shadowy. I don't know. Yeah, I haven't really made a whole lot of progress on this. Talked about it a bit in my vlog. I guess since my last podcast episode I've made progress, but not since the vlog. An inch or two, maybe. But yeah, it's coming slowly but surely. Definitely, but like I said last time, I need to concentrate on it. So, yeah. It's coming. I'd like to have it ready for the fall. We'll see. And then next up, living in my trundle bag from Matter Root. Next up is my Evermore cowl. This is the Bittersweet Cowl by Carrie Bostacogue. Sensing a theme. I love her designs. So yeah, this is just, it's going. It's a pretty mindless knit, but at this point it's too big to just be, like, carried around. And the stitch pattern is fun to knit. It is curling up quite a bit because it's mostly stockinette stitch. There is a stockinette stitch base pattern. But from when I've worked with Quince & Co.'s yarns before, they do bloom quite a bit when they're blocked. So I'm hoping this will bloom a bit and cut down on the blocking. Oh, and this yarn is Quince & Co. Osprey in the Rosa Rugosa colorway. So it's named Evermore after the new song from the new Beauty and the Beast movie, because it's just all the Beauty and the Beast. I am entering this in the Beauty and the Beast cowl that Gabby of the Once Upon a Corgi podcast is hosting. I'm excited to be done with this. It's a fun knit, but I have so many other projects that I want to cast on right now, but I'm trying to not just cast on all the things all at once. Because I'm trying not to do that, not to give into the cast on itis, I want to finish this before I cast on something else. I have a couple of shawls that I have the yarn ready for, so gotta finish this first though. It's an enjoyable knit, but it reminds me of why I like to knit things that are a little more interesting, just because it's the same thing over and over and over again. It's hard because I like to have some mindless knitting that I can throw in my bag and take with me places or do while I'm reading, but the knitting that I really love to do is the more complicated knitting, or at least something with a stitch pattern or some sort of texture or shaping or something going on. Rows and rows of the same stitch pattern over and over can get monotonous, and maybe there's times when I want that, but right now I want something with a little bit more interest. As I say that, let me show you my next project, which is mostly stockinette stitch, or it's going to be when I really get going on it. I am calling this my Buttercup vest. It is inspired by the outfit that Buttercup wears in The Princess Bride when she's on the farm. She doesn't wear a vest, but the aesthetics of the vest just remind me of the outfit that she wears and the colors. The sun is in and out today, so I apologize for the wonky lighting, but my parents are leaving this week on a trip to celebrate their anniversary, so now is the time that I had to record. Anyway. The pattern is the Brookdale vest by Elizabeth Smith, and the yarn is Knit Picks Wool of the Andes in the Amber Heather colorway. And my gauge was too small. Well, I had more stitches in 4 inches than the pattern called for. And I'm realizing, I talked about that last time, but I think that it's because it's the gauge after blocking, and the sample is knit in Quince & Co. And like I already mentioned, Quince & Co. has a tendency to bloom when it's blocked, which is gorgeous, but that does, the knitting grows, and so Wool of the Andes does not grow like Quince & Co. does. So that could be part of the why my gauge is 4 extra stitches to the inch, or not to the inch. Ooh, that would be nuts. I believe I have 4 extra stitches over 4 inches, which isn't huge, but it's enough, so I cast on a larger size than I had originally planned on. But it is, this is a, you know, a mindless knit as well. It's got a bit of a stitch pattern. I forget what she calls the stitch pattern. But there is this textured stitch pattern on the cuffs on both sides, and it has a garter stitch edging on the bottom, and then right now doing some decreases. Is it decreases or increases? A few decreases for just a little bit of shaping. Not a whole lot in the way of decreases or increases in the pattern, but just enough to give it a little bit of shape. So, and I'm using Wool of the Andes. I've never used this yarn before, but it's a very economical yarn, so I just figured I would try it out on a vest, see how I liked it, and I was going to be cutting it very close with the yardage that was required in the pattern, especially since my gauge is smaller, both my row and stitch gauge. So I wasn't sure I'd have enough yarn, so I went ahead and ordered 2 more skeins, and it was the same dye lot. Their dye lot's supposed to be massive, but it was the same dye lot, which was exciting. But I was definitely worried when 1 skein, let's see, where is my, 1 skein got me not even all the way through the garter stitch edging. And so far, I have another skein that's lasted me from about here all the way up to here, and I still have quite a bit left. I mean, because that did include swatching, but that was a little nerve-wracking, so. And I'm thinking I might make the vest a little bit longer than it is in the pattern. We'll see. We will see. I've never been much of a vest person, but I just love this one. So we'll see if I like vests after this. A lot of we will see in that project. So, I was realizing the other day, I went to go somewhere, and I was realizing I don't really have a portable project right now, like a very good portable car knitting project. Because I didn't have any socks in the needles. I finished my last pair of socks a few weeks ago, and almost always have a pair of socks in the needles. So I decided to cast on a new pair. Now, again, with socks, it's always a battle between vanilla socks are easy and easy to knit. Easy to knit anywhere when I'm doing anything, but then that's also boring, and I get very bored. And then I don't want to work on them. So then I remembered, as a giveaway from, I think from the Emily of the Fibertown podcast hosted a giveaway. Yes, it was for her, it was for her hand-spun knit-along. I don't remember what it was called, but you knit something out of hand-spun. And so I won the New York Sock Club, which is a collection of 3 patterns by Mina Phillips of the Knitting Expat podcast. So, 1 pattern was released at the beginning of March, 1 at the beginning of April, and another one is going to be released at the beginning of May. And so I had 2 of those sock patterns that I hadn't used yet. So, last night, I cast them on. They are just barely there, like five rounds maybe. But I'm knitting the small size. Her patterns are super thorough. She has instructions for cuff down and toe up and multiple sizes. So, just barely cast these on. Oh, and these are living. These are going to be living in this double pointed needle cozy from Molly Klein Designs. She had posted on Instagram that she had some Beauty and the Beast inspired ones, and I saw her post just like 3 or 4 hours after she posted it, and there were only a couple Beauty and the Beast ones left. I'm gonna check to see if she has any others in her shop, because these are gorgeous. She has a Beauty and the Beast project bag, and she does have a couple more needle cozies that are fabric with Belle and the Beast dancing on it. So she does have those left. But I chose this one just because, I mean, it's yellow, and I don't normally go for yellow, so I thought it might be fun to have that pop of color. Plus, it has tea. I mean, it's got roses and books and Mrs. Potts and Chip. Like, ugh, what's not to love? So, yeah. Those, they're the Grand Central socks. They were the March sock pattern in the sock club. I honestly don't know if those will be available for purchase after the sock club is done. The club includes 7 patterns. Oh, I didn't realize I had that many. That's exciting. Okay, so after the final pattern is released, so you can buy the club, you can buy it at any point until September 1st for $17, and then after the last pattern is released on September 1st, the full price is $19 for 7 sock patterns. And I've seen a few other people knitting the Grand Central socks, and with different kinds of yarn, and so it looks like a good mindless knitting, but still enough texture to be interesting. Enough of a stitch pattern to still keep me interested. So I'm using... Wow, sorry, this describing this project's all over the place. I apologize. I'm using some Knit Picks, leftover Knit Picks stroll in a tan color for the heels, cuffs, and toes. And then I'm using this yarn. This was some unlabeled sock yarn that was given to me along with a lot of other sock yarns. I'm thinking it's some sort of Barocco sock, because most of the other sock yarns that I received from the same person were Barocco sock, some line of Barocco sock yarn. And so I've got the tan and my main body colorway. And I've honestly never actually knit contrasting cuffs, heels, and toes. I don't know why. I think it's just because a lot of the sock knitting I've done has been with some sort of tonal or self-striping colorway, so not necessarily types of yarn that make good contrast for other self-striping yarns. But I do have enough, I've used Knit Picks Stroll enough times now that I have like this color, and then I've got like a chocolate brown that I think will make for good contrasts. So that is all that I have for knitting. I do have a bit of spinning, well, drop spindling, to show you. So, I had taken a class back in November to learn how to drop spindle, but then I hadn't really been working on it. Part of it was because I do a lot of knitting, honestly, like, sitting on my bed or on my couch. And in those cases, it's hard to drop spindle, especially when I'm sitting on my bed, because I need to be able to, like, I roll it against my leg and then let it spin, and it's hard to do that while I'm sitting on my bed. But we've had some gorgeous days recently, and I've just been going out and sitting on the porch and sitting on a chair and doing some drop spindling. So I haven't weighed this or anything, and I don't remember how much the spindle weighed, so I don't think that would help me much anyway. But I've definitely doubled the amount of yarn that I had on this spindle within the past week. And you can see, it's most definitely not perfect. You can see there's some, like, thick spots there. The yarn that, when I'd been working on it before, it had kind of been super twisted. And so I've been working on deliberately just trying really hard not to over-twist the yarn. I'm probably under-twisting it. Well, I know I'm definitely under twisting it in some spots, but it's so much softer. Like when I felt the spindle before I really started picking it back up within the past week, it didn't feel as soft. But now that I've been more conscious of not overspinning it, I can feel the difference. It is much softer. The fiber is undyed BFL that I purchased at Port Fiber. I've shown this a few times before if you've been watching for a long time. Purchased this from Port Fiber. You hear, you can actually see, this is the fiber that I, when I was took the class, there's a few other fibers mixed in the middle of this ball, just because from experimenting during the class, just trying different, some different fibers. So, I mean, this is what it looked like at the beginning of the class. Definitely thick and thin. Some rope-like qualities to some parts of it. But it is very twisted. And with having the white and brown fibers mixed together, you can see the twist. And this is not all that soft, except for in the thicker parts where I just didn't draft the fiber as thin as I wanted to. But then feeling and comparing that to this, I honestly, I don't know if you can see much of a difference, but I can see that this is more twisted. The fibers are definitely more, are twisted a bit tighter than those, than the ones on here. And I can feel a difference. So yeah, I've really been enjoying this. It helped that I was listening to an audiobook that I was obsessed with. So I would walk home from work listening to the audiobook and not want to stop. So I would just go and get my spinning and sit on the porch and continue listening. And it's definitely something that I want to be working on. Maybe not necessarily every day, but try to pull it out at least a few times a week. I don't have any plans for the yarn once it's done. I'll honestly probably leave it as a singles because you lose your yardage. You lose half the yarn if you ply it. I mean, I'm not going to be spinning enough to make anything big anyway. So, I don't know, maybe just some little fingerless gloves. I don't know. Or a little a headband, or if I do enough, maybe a small cowl. Just something where gauge doesn't really matter. So, yeah. Been doing some spindling, which has been super fun. And that is it for what I have been working on. But I do have some dream sewing. So recently, I went to look up a pattern that another podcaster mentioned, a sewing pattern, that was a McCall's pattern, and saw that I was on the last day. It was the last day of them having a sale where a ton of their patterns were $2.50. So of course I had to get four. I mean, so that ended up being the price of, like, one pattern normally. Because I want to be expanding my sewing, and I've also been thinking potentially towards Me Made May, which is something that I've observed over the past couple of years. I've just really watched, never participated in, but it's where makers, whether you're a knitter, crocheter, sewer, during the month of May, you wear handmade items and post it. I'm guessing it probably used to be mostly on blogs, but when I've been aware of it, it's been on mostly on Instagram that I've seen it. And you just post outfits with things that you've made. And the thing is, in May, obviously there are still days that are cold enough for hand knits here in Maine, but it's also starting to get warmer, so I've been thinking maybe if I can sew a few more things for my wardrobe, then I can have some more things to wear for that. For Me Made May. So, I got a couple of skirt patterns. This one has more, like, shorter skirts, like knee-length skirts for summer. This one, longer, like, maxi skirts. I love maxi skirts. They're my favorite. And so I've been thinking of wanting to make my own. So, I was super excited to see this one. And they're all, like, easy or beginner patterns. Three of them, this one's not, but the rest of them are like learn to sew patterns, which is fantastic. And then I love wearing dresses, but the problem is that during the summer, if you have to try to layer it, like wear a tank top underneath it, or you have to wear a slip or something underneath because it's more see-through, it's just, it takes away the ease of wearing a dress. I have one or two over the years that I've been able to just throw it on, wear it by itself, not have to worry about anything, like layering it with anything underneath. But I always look for it and look for dresses like that in stores. I can never find any. Just nice casual wear everyday dresses. So I picked up a couple of dress patterns from McCall's as well. First, I got this one, which I like these two because the neck is higher, which means I wouldn't have to worry about wearing a tank top underneath it. And they're nice, like, knee length, which is perfect for summer. So I got this pattern. So this is will be more, like, casual, everyday sort of dresses. And then this one where, like, you can see here the dress is a little bit more fitted, but it does have, like, some nice long dresses maybe for the fall. But I also really like this tunic-y top and leggings, which is something I would definitely think would be fun to make for myself because it's hard to find leggings that are super comfy that I really want to wear. So yeah, all in all, 4 sewing patterns. And I've been doing a bit of like fabric hunting, mostly looking on fabric.com for different fabrics that I would potentially want to use. But what I really need to do is just take a good look at my closet and see what colors I wear all the time but might not have a dress in that color. So find a fabric that is in that color, or just see other colors that I want to incorporate more in my wardrobe. Like, I love the color purple, but I realize that I don't really have a lot of purple clothing. Partially because I don't always like the purple shades that I see if I'm going shopping. It might be like, might not be light lavenders, and I like darker purples. So yeah, I need to just figure out what colors I want to incorporate in my wardrobe, and do I want to make solid colored things, or do I want it to be like printed? Because I love like pretty floral skirts, but then if I only have one or two shirts that match them, then it's kind of hard to justify paying a lot of money for really cute floral fabric if I'm not going to wear it that often because nothing matches it. For a dress, I'm thinking I want to do at least one dress that is a pretty floral pattern because you can wear a dress by itself. I don't have to worry about matching that with anything. But for the skirts, I need to figure out just what kind of fabric, what colors I want to use. And I need to find a good, like, top. I've been looking at maybe, I think it's called the Lark. Lark and Scout are two different patterns, I believe, from Green Line Studios. Let me just double check on that. So yeah, so I've been looking at maybe one of those, just because then I could also, because part of my problem is I have cute floral skirts, but then I buy brightly colored tops, so then they don't always go well together. But if I can find a good top pattern and just do a lot of neutral colors for tops, then that would allow me to make even more fun skirts. Okay, so the Scout Tee by Green Line Studio, which you just get the one pattern, but I know a lot of people make that and have raved about it. Or there is the Lark Tee, which is, I think it's called Lark. Yes, which has 4 t-shirt options, like a normal crew neck, a v-neck t-shirt, and then crew neck and v-neck long sleeves for the same price. So I'm thinking I might go with that one, because it has more options. So yeah, sewing is something I definitely want to get into more and learn more about. And thank you so much to everyone who on my last podcast episode left some great resources that I definitely want to explore more, some great resources for sewing. So I'm trying to figure out a good way to track what I'm sewing, because I love how Ravelry works for knitting. But what I've been doing, I've just written down, like, the pattern, like, the pattern name number, which view I want to make, and some ideas for the fabric, and just writing down, like, washing instructions, and the width, and what the fiber is made out of, just because for the other skirt that I made recently, the one thing I've sewn recently, it was a name brand fabric, so I can easily look that up. But for some of the fabrics I've been looking at for these projects, they are not name brand. So it might be hard to find it again. So I'm just writing down information that I might want to know. And then I'll write down what I end up using, maybe include a little bit of a swatch of the fabric. And yeah, just to help me keep track of what I'm sewing. So yeah, maybe in a couple of weeks I'll have something made. Maybe not. My parents are going away for a week and a half. It's the longest trip they've taken in ages for their 25th anniversary. So I'm helping to take care of my family, my siblings. I'm the second oldest of 9 kids. So I'm helping to take care of everyone. So I probably won't have tons of crafty stuff going on in the next couple of weeks. But I do hope to at least order some fabric and to get ready to start sewing some of these summer projects. I've also been inspired by Libby of the Truly Myrtle podcast. She also has some beautiful knitwear designs, but she's lately been talking about making a capsule wardrobe. For her, it would be a winter wardrobe in the coming months because she lives in New Zealand. But I've just definitely been inspired by hearing her talk about just intentionally choosing patterns and fabrics and figuring out just overall, like, she wants to incorporate more green in her she wants to incorporate the color green in her wardrobe, so finding ways to do that. So yeah, that's been inspiring me as I've been trying to figure out what fabrics to choose for what I want to sew, and even just what kinds of things that I want to make for myself. So yeah, that's it for sewing dreams. And then I just had a few things in my What's Making Me Happy segment. This is a segment where I just share things, might be what I'm reading, watching, eating, whatever. Just different things that I'm enjoying lately. So I mentioned in my spinning that I had an audiobook that I was obsessed with. It was, and I finished it, it was The Guernsey Literary and Potato Peel Pie Society. Oh my goodness, I love this book. It occurs just barely post World War II, and through a connection, a young woman who is an author gets connected with a group of people on the island of Guernsey. She lives in London, and Guernsey is one of the Channel Islands between the UK and France. And she gets in contact with someone over there, and turns out they have a literary and potato peel pie society that they started during the German occupation of the Channel Islands. And so she eventually goes and visits them and gets to know them. And I just love all of the characters. They're so just lovable and charming and quirky. And I did listen to it on audio. And I really didn't know anything about the book when I started listening. And so I didn't realize it was going to be consist entirely of letters written to and from various characters. And so when it initially started, I was listening to the first letter, and I was thinking, oh, it's going to be a letter, which I like reading. I like those kinds of books, but that might be hard to keep track of in audio form, because sometimes when I read books like that, I can find it hard enough. I forget by the time I get to the end of the letter, sometimes I forget who it was being written to. But in this case, there were multiple narrators, and every character had their own voice, so it was very easy. By the end of the book, I could easily recognize who was talking, which I loved. So I loved the audio version. I think I bought the Kindle book, and then I added the Audible narration when I bought it, which is oftentimes cheaper, because I can't pay $30 for an audiobook. So much money. Think of all the yarn I could buy. But sometimes if you buy the Kindle book, then you can add the Audible narration for just a few dollars. Sometimes it's still expensive to add the narration. But I'm subscribed to Modern Mrs. Darcy's Kindle Deals of the Day, and so sometimes, like, I'll check those emails, and it will say, these Kindle books are on sale, and then you can check them out, and sometimes, so you can get the Kindle book for, like, $3 and add the Audible narration for another $3 or $4. So, yeah, the Guernsey Literary and Potato Peel Pie Society. Love that book. Something else is Reese's Peanut Butter Eggs. It was Easter this weekend, and I love Easter, and I love all the we do a sunrise service and a breakfast and then a regular morning service at my church. But that also means I get some chocolate, and Reese's Peanut Butter Eggs are my favorite. They're great. I don't need to say anything else about that. Something else I've been enjoying is Lipton's. I bought some Lipton iced tea bags, like they're tea bags specifically made for iced tea, which is nice because I can just make a picture and put it in the refrigerator, and it has a lot less sugar and stuff in it than if I'd bought a bottle of iced tea or even used like the powdered mixes. So, plus it's green iced tea, which nobody else in my family really likes, so I get to drink it all. So I've been enjoying that on these days when it's been really warm lately. And the last thing that I've really been enjoying, I'll include a link to this in the show notes, but on YouTube I found a La La Land medley by a duo called Lord and Lady Music, and it includes City of Stars, Audition, and Someone in the Crowd. Oh my word. The way they combined them was beautiful. Because sometimes when you hear medleys, like, especially from movies like that, it's just one song, and then there's a transition in another song, and then a transition in another song. But this one, they layered them on top of each other in spots, and it was beautiful. So I'm a little bit obsessed with that cover right now. I think someone that I'm subscribed to had a La La Land medley, and then it popped up on the sidebar, and I clicked on it, and gorgeous. So yeah, those are all things that I have been enjoying and have been making me happy lately. So I just want to say thank you so much to everyone who watches my podcast. Thank you for all of your kind comments on YouTube and on Instagram. I love getting in contact with you, so go ahead and reach out to me on Instagram or Ravelry or right here on YouTube. And I would love to get to know you better and to know what's been making you happy lately. So until next time, happy crafting, and I hope you keep on learning from your mistakes. Bye.